He's used to this.
I went to Stephen Foster Elementary School.
Where is that, though?
That's in Lakewood.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, so they're still naming it after, like, people.
Really?
Yeah.
Was it Reggio? No, it wasn't Reggio,
was just
right?
Public. There's no fancy things.
Is it still good? That's the question, of course.
No, it was good. No, it was all right. I mean,
is it good? It created an Academy Award nominee, for the love of God. Yes, it's good.
We had really great teachers. I mean, that was a point where, you know, they were, it wasn't until like sixth grade. I had a teacher named Ms. Crab, and I was like terrified
no
to go
way.
To school. Yes.
Her name was Crab?
C-R-A-B-B-E.
Oh, my Lord.
And I'm like,
poor
I'm
woman.
I'm going to my mom, I'm like, get me out of this class, get me out of this class, get me out of this class. Because she was stern, but she was the teacher that, like, you know, you
everyone
have
the, feared.
You have that one teacher that turns
you
around.
I remember third grade.
Already have just, like, you know, with her, it was just like, from that point on, it was like, I just.
But did you love
I
her?
I saw her because, yeah, she was great.
I know. I ended up loving the one that I had just nightmares about. She was pretty harsh, though. She used to hit. We used to have these little notebooks that were this thick, right? Mm-hmm. So that you wouldn't lose your notebook. Mm-hmm. Third grade, you know, so I was 8. And when she will get mad, she will make you put your hand on the desk and slam that notebook. And then you could hear your bones go. And I thought, okay, if I can make it through the first month and not get my bones cracked, that would be a really good thing. She never hit me. She never hit me, but she had this love-hate affair with me that she would always send me to the front and make me do the whole thing on the chalkboard.
So do you have a book now?
I don't write anything.
No, but I mean just to like hit people's hands with? Is that
Victoria
part of your
does.
Gig?
She does that to us, and we don't.
I walk around with a happy stick, which is an inflatable baseball bat with happy faces,
that's
and that's what I hit people with. So that goes to show you how I don't follow in her footsteps.
So at what point, since we're in education land a little bit, what point do your lives, what is the word I'm looking, separate from being, because you're in the same field, but you're doing very different things, really, in some ways. Is there something that, a personality thing that takes you into different directions, or are they just are they different jobs before you even started doing the job?
The easiest way to describe it is like yin and yang is a great way to describe it.
Get out of my head.
Yeah. Well,
that's exactly what I thought.
Well, because again, it's you know, the great part of that symbol, it's not just a circle with a straight line through it. It's got the curve that like incorporates both sides. So a lot of what each side does overlaps. So much of what Victoria does, and I'm going to speak for you a little bit, but
sure.
In terms of the planning, is keeping all the creative in mind and making sure that what the movie needs to be can be obtained by what she's planning. And then part of my side of it is, you know, following through the creative ideas, making sure planning-wise, schedule-wise, what we shoot is able to like recreate that same vision. So it's you know, it's there's probably a certain point where your personality kind of lets you gravitate towards a specific thing. I think in terms of my side, I'm very, you kind of get into the details, and the Victoria's side is probably more, yeah.
But I think we're both storytellers, so you can either be in the minutia or you can be in the grand plan of it all, but at the end of the day, what wins is the best story. And so there is times where being focused on one particular event, as small as it seems, because it is part of the equation, is incredibly necessary. And sometimes it doesn't really make the equation go. So it's my job sometimes is to say, that's perfect that you're focused on that. And there's times where it's like, that's not where it's at. Because look, when you look at it this way, and usually he will say, ah, I get it. I still want it, but I get it.
And then you figure out how to try to get it.
Yeah, and then I awesome always try to get it for him. You know what I mean? It's like the whole idea is to try to get everything in that big bag of potatoes that you all can only, you know, it's supposed to, we want 100 pounds, but it can only carry 50. So how do you do it? Well, you shove 75 and you cry for the 25 pounds that you can't put in. So, but you got 25 more pounds that the bag said that it could hold. So,
did you ever want to be the minutia person?
I don't think I have the kind of brain that he has, in the sense that I don't think in those terms. So I don't think I don't think I'll ever be a visual effects supervisor. I don't think I'll ever be a director. That's not where my head is. My head is, I'm a producer, and I just take large teams of phenomenal, talented people and take a story, and we go across the world and we try and put it together and show it to the world. I don't think I'm the person with the vision. I can look at the vision and see where the gaps are, but somebody has to lay out the vision. I'm not that, today, I'm not that person. And I think he is that person.
Yeah, I'm the ooh, shiny personality where it's like, oh, that's really cool. Let's go over here and do that. And, but it's balanced with the, you know, as Victoria's saying, it's the storytelling, and it's with these films, the complexity of them. There's, you know, you're starting from scratch in so many things, and you're trying to keep building them up and building them up. And it's you know, again, that vision of here's all these broken Tinker Toys all over the floor that you've got like a year and a half to assemble them. And it's those things that's terrifying because they stay spread out all over the floor for the longest time. And it's not until the end where all those things that you put in place just kind of bring them all together and they stack up into a film. Which I think it's a lot of fun.
It is a lot of fun. And then sometimes you have this amount of floor, but when the movie is really there, you really only need this much. So letting go of these is painful.
Has it ever been that, I mean, is it at some point that you could just pare down and, I mean, are there things that come out when you're waiting and you're waiting and you're waiting? I always have this conversation with animation people who are, you know, the film comes together in the last 6 months after they've waited for 5 years. Where you go, oh, that really doesn't work?
Or, you know, every day. Every day.
But when an effect comes in, if you're not happy with it, it can't really be changed.
We try.
We do.
We try every day. Yeah. Every day. I mean, time, I always say time is the enemy in these movies. There is no enemy. We're a pretty cohesive company in the sense of how we manage and handle the creative and the needs of the film. But time is a four-letter word. Time is the enemy, and time will get it. It always wins. And so you just try to, you know, to give it up with as much integrity as you can.
But you'll fight it. You'll be here till 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning, all
Sometimes
night.
We don't go home.
Yeah, we don't go home. Because you'll fight the time. You'll want it. You'll try to get it.
We have figured out how to get 36 hours in 24 when you have, you know, Asia or Australia, New Zealand, and Europe all working together. So we're trying to figure out how to get 48 hours in 24 hours. But it's, yeah.
Are you fighting it after the movie's over, or after the movie's locked, or are you still kind of going,
we don't lock the movie.
Define locked.
we're always trying to, the one thing I would say is that in an effort to get the best story, the best thing that the fans deserve, and that's what we're after, right? These fans are lifelong fans. Some is a new generation, the 10-year-olds, but there's 50, 60, 70, 80-year-old people that have been, they've been holding on to these for like forever. Mm-hmm. So you have to do it right for them, and we only get one chance to do it right. So the effort is consistent in trying to do it for them the best possible way. And sometimes we succeed, and sometimes we almost succeed.
So how did you guys team up for this project?
Well, Dan was working on Night at the Museum 2.
Yeah.
And I was looking for a new person to come in. And he interviewed with us and the directors. And
so new because you continue to make so many more movies? And you're an expanding group of people? Is it just...
I have a core group of people that we always sort of keep together. And at that time, one of our supervisors had gone to do another film. Because sometimes there's too much time in between films and people can't wait. So it was time to get somebody that had not worked with us before. Because everyone that had worked with us either was working with us or was working on something else. And that's when Dan came about and he interviewed and got the job.
So is this the holy grail of that job? I mean, it's like, I want to be part of the family?
Yes. I mean, for a couple of reasons. One's because it's a great family. I mean, it's, again, I sometimes describe it, you know, like Camelot. It's just like something that, you know, the right group of people are together working on the right films, making something awesome. And then just as one of those fans that Victoria was just talking about, trying to, you know, please the fans. I'm one of those fans. So, you know, it's, you know, describe it as, you know, I was the kid that, you know, had the action figures at home, like crashing them together. And then now I'm like working on the films where I get to like take the actual people and crash them together.
You do pretty or they're a digital bot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it's just not hurt anymore.
It's like, hey, Chris Evans has to fall off the helicare. that was the digital versions of Chris, so that was good.
That's your pre-viz.
That's the pre-viz, yeah. That's
when right. You were 12.
No, right. And we did pre-viz. We'll have the action figures. I went, you know, you on Amazon, you ordered the action figures, so we're actually planning it out. You have the action figures there, and you have a group of people playing with toys.
You actually have to go to Amazon to get Marvel action figures?
You have to pay for it. We don't give them away. It's just
no
a policy.
It's
a policy.
So was this particular, I mean, this is one thing, very different, the second movie from the first movie, Captain America movies.
Big change. Design,
yes. Big design, right. But I mean, it's like, it's not the same, it's almost like a different piece of the universe. It's another, I mean, it's all these years later, but it's a very different style movie, it's everything else. Is that a good thing? Is that a hard thing? Is that, oh, okay, I expected it to be this, and I would have loved to have done a Joe Johnson style movie, or?
Well, I think it's the evolution of the character, and I think the Joe and Anthony Russo, the directors, did a great job of telling that kind of story of a character that, you know, kind of what Joe had done was the kind of the nostalgic version of Cap, and kind of, you know, in the tone of the tone of the comics, where, you know, and how we imagine that time in history, mm-hmm. and looking at it from a point of view that, you know, despite the film being nostalgic, you know, Cap being in a war, I mean, he had seen things, he'd experienced mm-hmm. things, he's, you know, loyalty and deceit, and, you know, he was a man of that world, but with a different set of morals. And then the whole idea to bring him into our world, because we did have the nostalgic feel, mm-hmm. kind of now kind of riffing off of the kind of the 70s, 3 Days of the Condor, kind of the conspiracy thrillers, and bringing Cap into that. So suddenly, you know, you've got a man that's been asleep for all those years with one set of values walking into our world. And mm-hmm. I think by necessity and by design, you know, that character now has to face that, and he's in a way that he would react to it. And you know, what was, you know, kind of his sense of morality and how he fought and his fighting style, suddenly he's in this real world, and not only did, you know, the way he would fight would change, but his view of the world is just, he's just not happy with everything they fought for in the 40s, he's not happy with what's happened now. Mm-hmm. And then through the course of the film, he sets about changing that and kind of doing it his way. You know.
Mm. So is it, I mean, this is probably the most, I guess, lacking in period is not even a sentence really, but this is kind of like a very, this is probably the most kind of naturalistic, I guess, part of grounded version mm-hmm. of Marvel film yet. I would say no, is that fair? I mean, Avengers has some of that.
I think the Iron Man movies are very grounded. I mean, they happen in today's land. They happen on Earth. They happen here.
Yeah, but they're in giant cliffs and they're in big great houses. And this kind of like feels more like an urban, kind of an urban setting.
Oh yeah, it's grittier.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, it's a grittier.
It's in a city. I mean, it's a
style.
City movie.
It's a DC film. Yeah. Yeah.
So I mean, does that you come into that and you're going, okay, I'm gonna, you know, lay this all out, is that bring in special challenges? Does it make it harder to emulate things that people are used to seeing? People are used to seeing Washington, people are used to seeing...
Yeah, I mean, it definitely ups the ante in terms of the realism. I mean, we always strive for realism, but in terms of having to, like, make everything grounded into that world, it influences your overall design, you know, and a lot of times, you know, with Avengers, there's, like, these really great shots of, like, seeing all the heroes as you fly through them and they're fighting through the different, you know, the aliens throughout the city. Whereas this film, we kind of started it with the idea of, okay, if we're basing our film on the 70s thrillers, we're going to use kind of that design and kind of what they had to shoot with, we're going to use that same idea. So, you know, even though there are a lot of visual effects, you know, the goal was to keep that same feel, not have a lot of trick shots, not have a lot of, you know, shots where, you know, basically it's, and it kind of lends itself with Cap 2, where his powers are kind of peak human ability. Mm-hmm. So he lives in this grounded space. So we're able to kind of incorporate all of that and kind of into the feel of the effects so that, you know, they are dirtier. They're not, you know, the helicarriers have to be dirty. The helicarrier bay is dark and dank like it is under a river, you know, mm-hmm. so it's not this kind of glistening sci-fi environment. And then all of that, I think, you know, just, you know, you want to, the effects need to balance or be in, you know, in line with what the feel of the film is. And so mm-hmm. just because, you know, Cap came into this gritty world, you know, everything around him kind of feels in, you know, the same way.
So is it a is there a lot of attempt to keep things in camera on a picture like this versus doing more effects? Or, I mean, there are things where...
But that's always our effort, right? Our effort is to always try to do it as photorealistic and in camera as possible. It's really difficult when you have crumbling buildings, or there is a Leviathan arriving in New York, or you're traveling through galaxies, or you have these massive helicarriers that are, I mean, you can never get that in camera because it doesn't necessarily exist. And if it did exist, it's really hard to get a permit for it.
Sorry, I stepped on your joke.
No, it's quite all right. You will be punished.
Well, Marvel says you'll be punished. You know what's going to happen.
No, Victoria said you'd be punished. Don't put Marvel on this. I don't need them to do that. but it's, you know, the realities are that you can't do everything in camera. You can't. You can't hurt actors and break their backs as we go. I mean, and it doesn't matter how much you want to be the in-camera person. That's just a safety issue.
So does a movie like this have more in camera than something like... Well, Guardians, obviously.
You know, I think by the nature of the sequences, I mean, one of the things that really grounds is sort of the fight sequences, you know, and just in that, but that's working with stunts. So it's like, you know, it's still visual, you know, there are the helicarriers, the helicarrier bay, and making Haley Atwell look old and everything, but there's also getting together with the other departments and something that, you know, you may have done, you know, from visual effects, you try to figure out and work with them and say, hey, how can we still do this, you know, as a practical stunt or a practical effect, but do it in a way that we can help you. So make this as awesome as you can make it, and if we're painting out wires, we're painting out pads, we're painting out rigs, we're painting out cameras, let me do that, and then we can still showcase kind of what maybe we haven't seen in a few years of something, you know, someone like Winter Soldier coming off of the off the car on the freeway.
Right.
You know, he tumbles head over, you know, onto the freeway, you know, from a car speeding along. And so, you know, that's really cool, and it's not a digi double, but when you look at the actual plate that we shot, there was like, you know, a big rig up top wiring him in, and there was like a kind of a carpet that we were basically dragging that the stuntman landed on. So, you know, we were able to now, with the technology, obscure all the things that allowed them to do a really cool stunt that they couldn't do before.
So it's kind of amazing, actually, how many mainstream or non-comic book or action or whatever movies, big movies, where they're doing that also. Mm-hmm. You know, like, people don't even realize now how much CG is involved in, you know, an indie film a lot of the time now, just painting things out and doing all that. Did the Wachowskis change this world in terms of that kind of thing? Like, doing great car sequences in this movie, truck chases and everything. I mean, did the universe of that change around then? Is that about when effects kind of came of age? Around Matrix 2, or...?
Well, I think effects have been kind of growing. I mean, you know, the big revolution, the first revolution, when Jurassic Park came out, right? I mean, that was huge. You know, we still had model shops. We still had, you know, there's still some optical printers around, but at that point, everything changed. Everybody started buying computers and then getting into that realm. You know, the first Matrix came out, bullet time, and I mean, there's always some film that defines kind of a new genre effect, you know, like Morphing came out and everybody was doing Morphing. Then Bullet Time came out, everybody was doing Bullet Time. And then, you know, what the next thing is, you know, I don't know. We'll probably come up with it on one of the Marvel films. But
do you guys look for that? I mean, is that like an opportunity to, do you go, okay, let's see how we push the technology?
If it lends itself
sure.
to the story.
Sure. I mean, like, if there's new technology, we want to be a part of it. If the technology can give us the outcome that we're after, we want to be a part of it even more. To do it just to do it's sake, that's not us.
Yeah.
We're not those people. There has to be a reason. We're not those people. So, not today. And that is usually because we don't have that time to experiment on something that may not have a use for the film, but just for the technology part of it. But everything that has been developed, used, or hoped for technology-wise in the last whatever years, 20, 30, we always try to put in. And if there is something new, we'll look at it and see, how does this relate to what we're doing in our film? Is there a use for it? Is there a use for it that today is efficient for our way of working? And we will use it if that's the case.
I seem to remember on Avengers, I had a big conversation with the effects supervisor on that, and there being a few things that were kind of breakthrough in that film. pushing?
When we were talking about the Hulk, you mean? The motion capture, the face capture that we did for that?
Maybe. I don't know. My brain is gone after 2 years. In the same room,
think
actually.
About my brain.
But you remember all this. But
I remember some of it. Not all of it.
We were actually just talking to a makeup person from Guardians, sure. The hair and makeup person, who was like, is the mentality of kind of the computer universe mentality of kind of sharing everything and everybody's building on the next thing where you guys all live as well? Is that kind of the same mindset?
Yeah, I mean, you'll leverage. I mean, you can see the films as they, you know, go through the years. You'll leverage off of whatever technology that came before, and then, you know, generally each film keeps getting better and better, you know, where you kind of keep building on it.
And do helicarriers get easier and easier over the years, or are they?
No, helicarriers get harder and harder because now instead of just, you know, being on a wide shot, you're now like featuring, you know, all the fights are happening throughout the helicarrier, so you're detailing huge sections of them. The models themselves become incredibly huge, and now you're blowing them apart. So once before, what just used to be a shell, now you've got all the interior decks to them. So when you blow them apart, you have like see all the decks and debris falling off and everything.
So does Marvel have like a permanent helicarrier department that has to?
We have a helicarrier parked outside. Do you see it?
It's right over
Dopey. How did you think I came here today?
I keep trying to figure out how not to make them crash.
They do seem to crash in almost every movie at some point, or be right about.
Well,
right?
You know,
to improve the design a little
bit. They need a lot of space.
So, what was the greatest challenge on this particular project?
Well, I think just the overall scope and then the number of shots.
The volume.
The volume. We had a cool scene when, kind of like, this is where we were kind of talking about the technology and how it grows and what lets us tell the story. So we have a scene where Haley Atwell plays Peggy Carter. We saw her in the first film as a younger version, and now Steve goes back to visit her when she's older. And what people really wanted to do, and what Marvel really wanted to do, was to keep Haley, but let her play the 92-year-old version of herself, so we kind of keep the consistency to the universe. So in that case, it was, you know, we started trying to do something with old age makeup, and I think it was just too big a hurdle between, you know, Haley's age to a 92-year-old, and the amount of makeup we needed to apply just was kind of was pulling back on our performance. But, you know, we really wanted Haley. So in this case, we went in and, you know, kind of jumped into that technology, you know, train and went through and did a lot of tests with makeup, ultimately decided that it was too restrictive. So when we photographed Haley, she didn't have any makeup on. She just had tracking markers. And we went in and digitally we cast an older woman that would reproduce Haley's performance, and, you know, giving the same lines, but with the older woman, we liked the wrinkles, we liked the kind of the feel of her face. And we were able to basically take Haley's performance and take the wrinkles from the older woman and marry those onto Haley. So when you're watching the film, you know, it's Haley as her 92-year-old self.
So have we ever seen that before?
To that degree, I think it was the first time. I mean, you've seen pieces of the technology before, but it was, to shoot her with no makeup whatsoever was pretty huge.
And is the challenge on that for the morphing of the two things to be seamless and not recognizable? Is that the
It's trying to preserve
part?
Preserve her.
Yes, preserve her. That's the trickiest part.
Preserve Haley.
Sometimes it's just easier to go all CG and have full control over the model and what all those muscles are doing, but you don't have any control of that when you have the performance.
Yeah.
But the promise to her was that we will keep your performance. So with that in mind, then it made it 10 times harder for the team to have that.
Which you had to do. I mean, because, you know, we're on set and we're all tearing up on set just for the performance she's giving. So, you know, the idea of keeping her was brilliant. It was just having to figure out how to do it later on.
Yeah. I mean, the promise was easy to make, but just to keep the promise was the hard one.
So is matching, I mean, what is the impossible part of it? Is it matching, having the other actress match the performance physically, or?
You match as close as you can, and then you'll do a time warp, basically, to warp if the dialogue's not given at the exact same time. You're warping it into place. It was one of those things that was impossible before we started, and then once we kind of got the system down, then it was like, hey, this isn't still difficult, but it wasn't as hard as, you know, not knowing how you're going to do it.
But it's like having two actors or two actresses that exactly the same size, and you could pick the same dress and you put them on those two people, same pair of shoes. One wears it exactly as it should. It fits to the T. The other one wears it almost exactly as it should be. And that almost part of it was the part that we didn't want to gamble with, because we promised that we will keep her performance. And I think because is that uncanny place where you can see it, but you can't really tell quite what is that is not fitting. And we're like, the more that we tried the other way, it was like, it's almost there. It's like 98% baked. It's almost there. It was like, okay, you know what? Scrap it. Because that 2% is what breaks it. Mm. It doesn't belong there. So we have to start from scratch and see how we can make it work so it all fits well.
Because it was the matching the two performances, and it was also getting the look, the feel, the correct feel for the 92 version of her. So 92-year-old version of Peggy. So it was, we went down one path where she was maybe 60, and it just didn't work for the story. Again, it goes back to the story. She's 60 years old. We have to make her feel older. So we got the 60 version and just backed away from it and went back with a 92-year-old version of it.
And also we had some shots where, for some reason, it worked.
Yeah.
And then you go to the next take, and it's so off. Mm. And you're like, what? It's just completely different. It's like, no, it doesn't work as an approach for us.
So how long did that one sequence take?
Oh my God!
Pretty much
the entirety, 18 months. Yeah. Because we started with that really early on, doing tests and stuff. So it took us beyond 18 months.
And what was the day like when it finally worked 100%?
Well, we always wanted more time.
Yeah, time.
So you're still wanting to fix it?
Well, I think if we could go back, we probably would work on a couple of shots.
Yeah. And will it be easier the next time?
Yeah. It'll be easier. I mean, it's one of those things where we were developing as we went, so it'll be easier next time.
So you know the pieces of the puzzle to make that work.
Yes.
You now know what they are.
Yeah.
And so now there's details that are difficult, but you actually know how to do it.
Yes.
It's almost like we dug the trench. That we can actually walk through. Not to say that walking on that trench is easy, because it's painful and it takes time and effort, but we sort of know what the trench is.
Yeah, it will still be incredibly difficult and take many hours, and we'll go right to the end. But
yep.
Well, it's always a fascinating thing when we talk about effects, because the bar, no matter how far anybody gets, the bar keeps on moving.
You
know, it's constant, and like for me, one of the landmark moments was I thought in the third Transformer movie. Like, he finally got the robots to act. Whether the movie was any good or not, or whatever, other issues. But I feel like when he started, the technology would not allow that to happen. Mm-hmm. And somehow within the 6 years or 8 years or whatever it was, that the technology moved far enough ahead that he could actually get that thing. Whether it worked or not is but the effect. But that's the moving train of it all is kind of stunning.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's where a lot of it can be attributed to a portion can be attributed to computers getting faster. You can do so much more now with the tools you have, but you're also seeing a generation of artists that grow up on the tools. They're in high school. They can, they can download versions of the software, same software that all the visual effects facilities use, and learn that. So by the time they get to college, they already have been animating, and they get into the visual effects house, and they've already been doing it. So it's just, the artistry of your people is at such a higher level now that you're seeing just truly amazing work.
You seem awfully young to be an old man in this business.
I'm not as young as I look, but
I'm probably not as old as you feel.
I was young when I started.
He was a baby. I noticed you didn't say that about me. That's just so mean.
You get younger every year.
Cover up. Get that on camera. Cover up.
But no, but you're not talking about being old. He sounds like he's those kids come up and they're, the young, fresh.
Well, when I started, I had an IBM PC. And it was basic. And I was like, It was this big. Big. And, I was like trying to program the Death Star in basic with a little drawing a circle, and blowing it up by drawing random lines out it, and then. So everything when I started, a lot of the tools we needed, we wrote ourselves and we created ourselves, and it was all new pioneering technology, and so much of your time was just trying to get it to work.
Yeah, you didn't have a base to start from. There was no grounds for it. Now there is a full on box of tools, and we use that all the time, and then. Yeah. We create more.
And so all that time you spent just trying to get it to work, now you can spend on making it look great. So it's post-production schedules have shrunk, but you still have all that time to actually work on the shot rather than just trying to get it to work.
But it sounds like the people who come into this business are still very self-selecting and very motivated.
You have
not
to
all
be.
People yeah. wandering into your job, into, you know, effects.
Well, I mean, I try to tell people that, you know, that want to get into it, you have to love it. You're going to want to love it because you spend so much of your life here, you're going to get 20 years into it and realize and look back and say, you know, either you loved it and you're saying, this is great, or you're like, where'd my life go? So.
it's in a dark room down there. Yeah.
You have to like sitting in the dark
uh-huh.
for a majority of the day.
It's in a dark room over there. That's where your life goes. Go get it.
With a glowing white screen in front of you.
But you get to play with Captain America.
You get to play with Captain America, which is the best part.